Om Shri Chinmaya Sadgurave Namaha. My salutations to Swami Krishna Priyananji and to all of you present here. Pranams. I'm extremely sorry to keep you waiting. I have left from Kaff Parade at 5:13 and still I'm here only at 7:15. So tomorrow I shall leave at 5. Very happy to know that so many of you have come here. Just before I begin, how many of you are new to Chinmaya Mission? Thank you so much. So our topic is dynamics of karma. This word karma is a very well-known word nowadays, very well accepted also in, you will find it in the modern English dictionary also, in Oxford dictionary also you will find it, accepted in the medical field also. And sometimes it is used by every one of us. When something goes wrong, why did it happen? My karma. Why did I reach late today? Karma. Why did you have to keep waiting today? Karma. So many times it is used in that sense also. So I want to begin by asking you a few questions. How many of you believe that you were destined to come here? You were destined to come here. It's fated that you have to be here. Okay. How many believe that you made a choice to come here? I'm coming, one by one. How many believe that choice was also destined? Swamiji, I want to raise my hand for all the three. You see, some people believe that we do what we do because it's our choice entirely. Some people believe, no, it is written by some force because of which we are here. And some believe, no, our choice is also written by that force only. So how do we understand this? One of the most common questions which comes to us many times in question answer session is on this fate and free will, or destiny and self-effort. That is it that we are fated, that everything is predetermined and that God has written our destinies. Because we come to hear, no, many times, whatever He wills only will happen. Then what is the point of our free will? Or does man have any free will? And if at all he has free will, then how free is his will? Or is it that his free will also is determined by God only? That it's an appearance, you know, that okay, you have choice, but actually it is all destined. So many times in life, we swing between these three different options. When I am very successful, my choice. When something goes wrong, takdeeri aise likhi bhagwan. And if I become philosophical, then that choice is also predetermined only. You don't have any free will. So now the question is, how do we understand this? All these questions are based on the understanding of karma. So what we have to understand is this first and foremost. That what is action or what is karma? Because once we have the understanding of karma, then these things become very clear to us. So let us understand what exactly is karma, what are the laws of karma. What I am going to take over the next 3 days, some of it is based on the Gita. So I am not going to cover chapter 3 shloka wise. Some ideas we have lifted from there, from the Gita. And so based on the Gita and based on the Vedantic scriptures, we have presented it here for the easy understanding of everyone. So first and foremost, now we understand what exactly is karma. Because the topic is dynamics of karma. So a few questions. Is any movement called as karma? Yes, no. Any movement is called karma? Fan moves so fast, karma? No? Is activity. Activity need not be equal to karma. If I sit and think, is it karma? Thinking is not karma? I am going to ask questions only because my job is to make you think. My job is not to give you a lecture. So I do this, I keep asking questions. And there was this couple, the name of the husband is Sam and the name of the wife is Sarah. So samsara is actually split like that, Sam and Sarah. So they asked the child that whom do you love the most, Sam or Sarah? So he said, I love Sarah. So again they asked, whom do you love the most? I love Sarah only. For the last time, make up your mind, whom do you love the most? I love Sarah only. So Sam has been asking. He says, why do you love Sarah? Because Sarah doesn't ask so many questions like you. So anyway, the point is that, is any movement called as karma? If I just sit and think, is it karma? Because many people say that, I just thought about it, Swamiji, I didn't do anything. Why should I be suffering for that? I only thought of that person in a negative way or in an angry way. I didn't do anything. So there's nothing wrong about it. If I feel angry towards someone, is it karma? Because it's a feeling. So feeling is karma, but thinking is not karma. In daily life, we unknowingly destroy so many living organisms. Is it added to my karma?
Yes.
No. Nowadays, dengue is so common. If I kill mosquitoes, is it added to my karma? Unknowingly, I am walking and so many jiva himsa happen. So many beings are crushed under my feet. Even when I am breathing, I am living. So many things are happening where every minute organisms are dying. Is it all added to my karma? I don't do anything but instigate someone to do something. Is that also my karma?
Yes.
I didn't do anything. Mantra didn't do anything but whole Ramayana happened. Is it her karma or not?
Yes.
Intelligent audience. In sleep I kick my neighbor. Is it my karma? Sometimes knowingly kick but pretend I am sleeping. So is that my karma? No, unknowingly I kick somebody, that is my karma. Think about it. So these are just to make you have a different understanding of karma. Karma is, in simple way, if you want to understand karma, it is this. Karma is equal to action done by the body, mind, intellect. BMI means body, mind, intellect. Don't think body mass index. Body, mind, intellect. So whatever karma is done by the body, that alone is not called karma. Thinking also is a karma. Feeling also is karma. Then the intention with it which it is done, that is very important. A doctor also takes a knife and cuts open somebody's stomach, and the murderer also will do that. But are both of them equal?
No,
because the intention is very different. Even if that person whom the murderer tried to murder did not die, and the person whom the doctor was trying to save died, will the doctor be punished?
No.
So the intention is different. So what many people do is they understand this, that the attitude matters more than the action. But the third part is very important, is the doership. As long as the doership is there, only then it is my karma and I have to face the karma phala. If the doership is not there, like in sleep, when I am kicking somebody, there is no doership. So that karma is not added. Unintentionally, so many jivas are dying, that karma is not added. So this definition of karma is important. That karma is done with body, mind, intellect, along with the intention, backed up by the doership. If this definition of karma we understand, then we have understood karma properly. Then we go ahead to understand the further aspects with the laws of karma. So the intention determines the quality of our karma. It is not just the action. How I, with what intention I do, with good intention I do, it is a good karma. With a negative intention I do, it is a negative karma. Even though externally it may look very nice. Some people give charity like that. They give donation. Externally it will look a very nice grand thing, you know, this person is so generous, he gave donation, this, that. But internally the attitude will be, what is the use? That fellow is coupling me all the time with those who are khatam karu. Then the intention is very different. So intention determines the quality of karma. This applies everywhere. And doership determines whether it is my karma or not. So once we understand this, that action is nothing but anything done with our body, mind, intellect. In fact, feeling and thinking are also actions, and they are more powerful than actual action because they are the seeds. So now we come to this fact that how does karma work? Because not many people, I mean many people don't believe in karma also. They say there's nothing called karma and this, there is only one life. And whatever happens, happens randomly by chance. Anyone believes that? If you believe that, please be happy. There's no problem. You stand up for your belief. You don't have to worry whether others believe or not. So karma is action and it is the cause, and karma phala is the result, which is the effect. And in simple language, not in the technical language or in Sanskrit or scriptural language, in simple language, karma is, our whole life is an expression of karma. Why we are born, where we are born, what we are doing in our life, each and everything is an expression of karma, meaning it is an expression of the law of cause and effect. And this is universally applicable. Swamiji, does karma work only for Indians? Because we are aware of the karmic theory. So does karma work only for Indians? Or does it work for everybody? It's a universal theory of cause and effect. We call it as karma and karma phala. Because if we don't believe in cause and effect, just think about it. How life will be. It will be, everything is random chance. So you sow a mango seed, you don't know what will come out. Mango fruit won't come. Because it is not dependent on cause and effect. It depends on random chance. You are studying medicine, but you may not become doctor. Just imagine. If we believe that everything is chance and there is no choice and there is no cause and effect relationship, then there is a problem. So if I believe that this life is created randomly, I just came into existence from nothing and I will perish into nothing. So there is only one life. And who has seen the next life? So eat, drink and be merry. Why follow morality? Why follow ethics? Why follow any rules? Because that thinking is based on this denial of cause and effect. And I don't believe in cause and effect. And I have seen intelligent, so-called intelligent people, very rational, very scientific, but they have this view of life. That karma, there is nothing called karma, there is nothing called karma phala. Life is just random. It just happens to be, that's all. There are lots of laws, so I won't go into much of it, but just to draw your attention that it is a universal philosophy of cause and effect. And as long as our reasoning is there, as long as we are human beings, we have an intellect. Intellect works in the realm of cause and effect. In fact, Gurudev Swami Chinmayaji always used to say that causation hunting is the preoccupation of the intellect. Intellect always wants to know the cause. Now, if we are doing any research, what are we trying to do? Cancer research, so much is happening. What are we trying to do? Find the cause looking at the effects. And once I find the cause, eliminate the cause, then effects are gone. Everywhere it is that we have to find the root cause. If there is so much of corruption in our country, what is the root cause? The root cause is selfishness. Go into that depth of the root cause and try to work at that and then eliminate. Then the effects will go away. So causation hunting is a very important aspect, and that is what the buddhi does, that's what the intellect does. And based on that law of cause and effect, which we see operating everywhere. Otherwise, how is it that there is so much of variety in this world? Is it just a product of chance? There was one disciple who went to the master. He was studying with the master in the monastery. And the disciple one day asked the master that why is it that some people are born poor? Why is it that some people are born rich? Why are some having special talents and why are some people specially challenged? Why is all this there? Why is somebody a king? Why is somebody a slave? What is the logic? And the master answered very beautifully. He said, a slave is a slave because he is free. A king is a king because he is free. You are what you are because you are free. Means what? That all of us have the capacity to think, and what we think will continuously make our future. So karma is a law of cause and effect, and that works. Today's karma is tomorrow's karma phala. So now we are going to see six laws of karma, so that we have a comprehensive understanding of karma, and based on that then we can answer those earlier questions, and then we know how to face life. Because why is it important to know this? Because every moment of our life is an expression of karma. Not only every moment now is an expression of karma, my tomorrow completely depends on my today only. So if I am not alert enough, unconsciously I am building karma, sometimes which I don't want also. In Sanskrit we always say that people want lot of punya karma and they want to enjoy, but they continuously keep doing pap karma. Desire is for happiness, but the choices are towards unhappiness. Everybody wants bliss, everybody wants happiness, everybody wants permanent peace, but actions that we do constantly lead us to anger, jealousy, stress, worry, tension, anxiety. And nowadays that is so common. We don't even realize that it is our choices which are getting us these. Many times we blame the outside circumstances more than our choices. So important point to understand about karma is that if I understand karma well, I can use my purushartha, I can use my self-effort now and make my life as I want to. They are called strong people who take charge of their life. They are weak people who keep victimizing themselves. Why are you like that? Why are you so sorry? Why are you feeling so sad? What to do, Swamiji? My mother-in-law is not loving to me. My boss doesn't recognize my talent. Government is not proper. Economy is going down. Onion prices have hit 100 rupees. Something. Huh? 100, not 800. 100. 800, no. So the point is that if I understand karma well, I can live alert. And this capacity only a human being has to make choices. Nobody else has. An animal cannot make an intelligent choice and make its own destiny. But human being can. And we have seen lives of so many great people, in spite of what has been, what they have been subjected to or what they have faced, yet they are able to achieve what they want to achieve because they use their purushartha. Dr. Abdul Kalam, he wanted to become a pilot, he could not become a pilot. He cleared everything, but finally in the vision test, he could not clear that. And he felt so dejected. Finally, when he was sitting in Rishikesh and very sad, he saw Divine Life Society. So he went there and he met Swami Shivananji. Swami Shivananji was the Diksha Guru of Gurudev, Swami Chinmayananji. So there, after the satsang got over, Swamiji asked him that, young man, what has happened to you? Why are you looking so sad? And he explained that I did this and I couldn't clear the vision test and I wanted to become a pilot. And there it is said that two things Swami Shivananji said changed his whole perception. One thing he said is, so what if you couldn't become a pilot? There may be greater things in store for you. And is it not true that good he did not become a pilot? Today he is the rocket man of India. And second thing he said is, defeat the defeatist in you. And in each one of us there is a defeatist, which keeps on saying, you are not good enough, your life is not in your control, you can't achieve what you want to achieve, other forces are more powerful, you are incompetent. All the time it will keep pulling us down. That's why in the Gita 6th chapter, Bhagavan says, Uddhared Atmana Atmanam. Lift yourself by yourself. Don't ever look down upon yourself. Na Atmanam Avasadhi. So one who knows this very well, that my life can be as I want, I have to put that much of effort. So understanding of laws of karma will give us that steady ground and firm understanding. So we see the first law, which we have already seen a bit, that action is anything done with a sense of doership through the body, mind, intellect to get happiness. And every action will produce result. Every action. Every thought we think also produces result. Every feeling we go through also produces result. It is not only manifesting outside when we do as action that it produces result. This our culture has said thousands of years ago. But we will believe only when it comes out as a movie called The Secret. Law of Attraction. You attract to yourself whatever you constantly think about. What you think about, you bring about. Thoughts manifest as things. Because what appeals to us, you know? Packaging. Nicely packaged and given to us. The same thing is given in a traditional way, but it needs to be packaged. Fair enough. So the idea is that what we think also gives us karma phala. In fact, don't you see the result that all of you are sitting here? Why? Because many of you maintain the thought, no, that today evening, 6:30 I have to leave, 7 o'clock I have to reach, 7 to 8:30 will be the lecture, I will attend that. You maintain that thought consistently, so you are here. So what we do, what we think, each and every thought builds up. So one has to be very, very careful of the thought. So when we apply the law, first law tells us that from the unicellular to the human being, how have we evolved? We have not evolved by choice. We have evolved by instinct. Nature pushes. A fish doesn't want to become an amphibian by its choice. Nature will push. How many ever years it takes or births it takes, it will go. So it is said in our culture that 84 lakh species we have to go through to come to the first human birth. 84 lakh species are not births. In each species there are lots of varieties. How many births we have gone through each of them, we don't know. But 84 lakh species we have to go through, then we come to the first human birth. In all those births, what karmas we have done, that can we call it as our karma? Why? Because the doership is not there. That's why the definition of karma is important. Karma is equal to action done with BMI plus intention plus doership. So what we have done till the first human birth, there is no karma bandhan. In human birth, we have the choice. We have been given the intellect. We can think, rationalize, analyze, choose. And those who use that power, over many, many births in human life, we have done many karmas. Those karmas, not all karmas have yielded the fruits, because every karma doesn't give the fruit immediately. This one birth theory has that another flaw. If I believe only in one birth, that means every karma has to give result in this birth only. Which we don't see happening. And if we say no, if it doesn't give result, that means it's okay, it's over. Then there's a logical flaw again. That means an action is done, but there is no result. Then we don't know which action will give result, which action will not give result. So, not all actions have yielded the fruits, and hence we call that all those actions which we have done, which do not give us the result, that is our total bank of karma, which we call as sanchit karma. Sanchit means that which is very well collected. So we have collected lots and lots of karmas through the earlier lives, because suddenly when I come from the animal realm into the first human birth, one is not going to become so highly evolved that every action will be selfless, nice, divine. There will be animalistic tendencies because of which we act in the same impulsive way. Even today, don't we have that impulsiveness? Impulsively we get angry, we get jealous, we get lusty, we get passionate, we get irritable. Impulse happens. So many, many lives that way one has done, and that bundle is called as sanchit karma. Even if one has thought, that has built a karma phala. If it has not given the result, in time it will give. So this is the first law. The implication of first law to understand is this, that whatever karma we have done, it is going to give result, and there is a total bank of karma because of which we are here where we are. And this life is not an independent effect of chance. There is a basis behind it, which is my karma which I have done earlier. Now, second law says that results are nothing but cause or the action itself in another form. And whatever karma phala we get is nothing but karma itself in another form. The actions that, suppose a student writes an examination, that is his karma. The marks will not be nothing but a reflection of his karma, examination, what he has written in the paper. The potter makes a pot, then that pot is the effect of what? The mud. Mud is the cause. The cause itself in another form is the effect. So all our results are nothing but action itself in another form. On this we have a control. On what? Actions. We don't have control on the result. This is the basis of the second chapter famous verse, Karmanyevadhikaraste Mahaphaleshu Kadacha. In that, the word adhikara, karmanyevadhikaraste, it is a very famous verse, but most misinterpreted verse also. Because the translation of it will be given as, you have only the right to act, you have no right to the results. Then if there is no right to results, then why should I act? So many people say that this philosophy of the Gita is very impractical. Because they use the word adhikara in the meaning in the Hindi language. In Hindi, adhikara means a right. But in Sanskrit, adhikara means qualification. So you have, as a human being, we have the qualification to act, to choose, which nobody else in the creation has. Only human has. But we have no capacity to govern the result. Why? Because the results are governed by many, many cosmic forces. So the example always given for that is, it's like the arrow which we shoot. Now the arrow which we shoot, the control is there till when? Till it is in our hands. The moment we leave it, after that there is no control. There is the wind, there is gravity, there are so many other factors which will influence this. Whether it will hit the target, not hit the target, it will go somewhere else. But I can aim, I can consider all the factors and act according to that. Same way. So action is the cause, result is the effect. So if I focus on the action, result will take care of itself. And that is what one has to do. That Karmanyevadhikaraste shloka is a very, very nice shloka, and Gurudev used to call it as the economics of thought. You know, we are worried more about economics of money. But thought, economics of thought, that how to conserve the thought energy. Because when I get obsessed with the result, when I am attached to the result, then I get anxious. I get stressed. I am worrying about the future. And I am losing my capacity to act efficiently in the practical. How can I work without expecting a result? Did Bhagwan not expect a result out of the war? That dharma must be protected. Was there expectation or not? There is an expectation. But there is no insistence that this alone has to happen. We keeping that goal in mind, put all the energies there. But whatever result comes, accept. Bhagavan went as a peace messenger to the court of Dhritarashtra, expecting that peace will happen, that war can be avoided. And he tried his best. He tried to convince Dhritarashtra, he tried to convince Duryodhan, he tried to convince Karna also. He tried to convince different people. So he put in his best, but when the result came, did it come up according to his expectation? No, he had to accept that now war is inevitable. I have done what I have to do. So expect and accept. That is what Karma Yoga will begin with. That first I must expect. Whatever my goal is there, I expect, because that will channelize my energies. But I have to then focus on the action and do that action very well. I always give this formula, sure formula. 100% this formula works. If it doesn't work, money back guarantee. What is the formula? It's a formula for sorrow. Insistence plus resistance is equal to sorrow. If I insist that this alone has to be, I won't accept anything else apart from this. That insistence is going to create sorrow. And resistance, why this happened to me? So many people ask the question, why me? If it is for the neighbor, they don't ask, it's okay, let the neighbor. But why me? So insistence plus resistance is equal to 100% sorrow. Nobody says that don't focus on the goal. But insisting on that, getting attached to it, then getting anxious, we lose all our energy. So focus on the action, the result will take care of itself. So first law is whatever I do with the BMI, with the sense of doership, to get happiness from the world outside, that is called as karma. And every karma will give us karma phala. Second one says the results are nothing but action itself in another form. Third one says that the results are governed by time and cosmic laws. Not every result will come immediately. So time, results are governed by time, and they are also governed by cosmic laws. Just like externally there are laws, law of gravity, law of action, so many different laws which are there. That way, internally also there are laws, which is what we call as ethics, morality, values, all that. So, as far as time is concerned, the result may come immediately, the result may come tomorrow, the result may come after a few years, it may come even after some lives. The example given for that is, in the same garden, there are different plants which are planted. So, one is a tomato, one is a coconut, one is a mango, one is a grape, another orange. So the soil remaining the same, manure remaining the same, sunlight remaining the same, water remaining the same. Will every tree give the fruits at the same time? Same way in the field of life, different karmas we have sown. Which karma will take how much time to fructify and give us karma phala, that is not in our hands. So time governs the results. And also the cosmic laws govern the result. So when the action is done with the proper intention, that is a very important aspect. Many people ask this question that, you know, why do good people suffer? It's very interesting if you note who asked this question. Good man never asked that question. He never says that I am a good person, why am I suffering? Did Prahlad ask that question? Why do good people suffer? I am taking the name of Bhagavan all the time, and why is my own father killing me? He didn't ever get victimized. He never said, why me? He never said, I am the victim of child abuse. At such a young age, my father has been trying to know. Because the goodness in that person is so much that the goodness only protects that person, and the person feels so peaceful, no matter what is the external circumstance. So why do good people suffer, and why are the bad people getting away with it? Why are they not getting the karma phala? The moment one bad karma is done or a good karma is done, the immediate internal result happens. Externally, the result will come in time and nobody can prevent it. But internally, the result is immediate. The moment I think good or I do something good for somebody, I feel happy, feel selfless. The moment I cheat, it starts. Conscience prick starts. I may become as thick skinned as a rhinoceros, doesn't matter, but that doesn't mean that there is no conscience prick. It is there. So every karma will give the result. And it, though it may be time, do not ever think that karma phala will not come. That's why the first law we said, every karma will give result. It is 100%. And are we not seeing so many people? Sometimes it is delay because of human intervention also. Our judiciary is like that. How many years it takes to prosecute? But somewhere it will catch up or not. Karma will catch up. That's why I always say that you may escape the judiciary, you may escape the bureaucracy, you may escape the police, you may escape the government, you may escape any agency, CBI, but you can never escape karma. Karma will catch up. There is no doubt in that. Because this is the cosmic intelligence. Bhagwan is the karma phala data and karma phala adhyaksha, the result will come. If I have set a karma into motion, it will bring me the result and I cannot run. Nowhere, no matter where I run, the karma will catch up. Nobody can run from one's own karma. In the scripture, there is an interesting incident. Bhishmacharya, he was lying on the bed of arrows and he had that boon of Ichhamrityu. So he can drop the body whenever he wants. So he was waiting for the Uttarayan day to drop the body. So he is completely on the bed of arrows, fully. So when the war is over, everybody gathers around him and Sri Krishna tells Yudhishthir that the royal sun is going to set and he has such wise experience. Just ask him how to rule, and that in the Shanti Parva, beautiful Raj Dharma he has given, Bhishmacharya, that how to rule, what are the qualities of a king, what all he should do, how he should take care of the Praja, everything. And he also, he is the author of this Vishnu Sahasranam also. Very popular one which we keep chanting, Bhishmacharya, he is the author of Vishnu Sahasranam. It comes there. So Bhishma, when he is looking at Shri Krishna, he asks Bhagwan that, oh Lord, please tell me, I have gone into 72 lives before and I don't find any reason why I should suffer like this. Today we are talking about past life regression as a fashion. This has been there in our culture. So he went, 72 lives behind he went, scanning through every life consciously. Why is it that I am suffering like this? Please tell me. I have not done any such ghor karma to go through this kind of a karma phala. So Bhagwan says, go two more lives behind. And he does that. And it is said that he found two lives before when he went. After 72, he went two more lives before. And then he found that he was a tribal boy. And one day when he finished taking bath in the lake and he came out, his clothes were on a shrub, so he took them, he wore them. And then just out of his boyish enthusiasm, he saw that there was a insect which was there on a leaf. So he took that leaf, there was the insect, and he broke a thorn and he poked that insect. So Bhagwan said, 74 lives later, that insect who was Arjun has settled the karma. Not only that the karma phala one cannot escape, but the karmic accounts between the jivas also Ishwara ensures that they are settled. So many people say, Swamiji, that person, what he had to do, that person is continuously doing. And the person may have died also now, but that person escaped, no? Nobody will escape. If there is a karmic account between you and that person, it will settle like that only. It is not that you will settle it with somebody else. That is one of the reasons why many gurus are very alert. They don't make disciples. Because of the disciples' karma, guru has to be reborn. He said, no, no. So anyway, point is that karma will give result. Time, we have to understand, is a very important factor. In time, the result will come. So never believe that you will get away with karma. Never. One can never get away out of karma. Karma will catch up. Whatever be the situation, when the karma phala is ripe, it will come. Hence the third law, the time and the cosmic law. So when I understand this, two things one must apply. One should understand what is God's role in this now. If there is a karma and there is a karma phala coming, in time it will come. What is God's role? Does God do anything? He is the judge. Why should he be the judge? He has created a system. In the computer there is a system. You press A on the keyboard, A will come. The maker of the computer has to do nothing after that. He has already made the system. So he made a system. Good karma gives good result, bad karma gives bad result. These are good, these are bad. Everything documented, given to us in the form of the Veda and the scriptures. Done. Why I am asking this is because many of us believe that God wrote all this in my destiny. And Gurudev used to always say that God has better things to do than write dirty lines on your forehead. You are the creator of your destiny. And what is God's role? This is God's role. God is the cosmic intelligence who made the cosmic laws. And he is that intelligence which ensures the enforcement of the cosmic laws. And the freedom that we have as a human being, all that is the design of the Lord. What I do after that with that freedom is 100% my choice, and according to that will be my karma phala. If God is the incarnation of all love, happiness, peace, bliss, why is there so much sorrow in this world? Did God create sorrow? In the Ishwar Srishti, there is no sorrow. Have you seen a tiger tensed up? Pata nahi kahan se khana aaya. Competition bahut badh gaya. Is the tiger scared that I am going to get extinct? No. In Ishwar Srishti, there is no sorrow. There is no dukkha anywhere. In Jiva Srishti, there is misery. Why? Because of selfishness. A human being has made this planet terrible. You take human being out of this planet and put him in Mars. You see, Earth will be wonderful. You don't have to save the Earth. Earth is already saved. But then Mars will get destroyed. If you see that movie, you know, long back there was a movie called Matrix which came. In that they compare, you know, the human being. They say the human being is just like a virus. It breeds and keeps on growing. It infests an area and then moves to the next area, infests that, then moves to the next. Spoil that whole thing. A human being has created sorrow on this planet, not the Lord. So the Lord has created the whole Srishti, cosmic intelligence, and he is a dispenser of fruit of action according to the cosmic law. It is not that if I go and break 20 coconuts every Monday, I will get a very good husband. Whichever husband you have to get, that only you will get. No, but then what is the point of breaking that coconut? You are invoking special grace of the Lord, that new karma you are doing. But if by prarabdha there is a husband already fixed, that only will come to you. But your future husband will be different. So Guruji always says a joke. He says that marriages are made in heaven, and so is thunder and lightning. So, the idea is that when I do prayer, I am invoking special grace of the Lord. Jokes apart, when I do prayer, I am invoking the special grace of the Lord, and that gives me that strength to, that is the purushartha, which we are saying, to push through whatever is the karma phala I am going to get, I will have the capacity to bear it. Without those coconuts, I would believe that this husband has come because of my karma. After the coconuts, I believe that has come by grace of Bhagwan. So my relationship may be better. So anyway, the point is that God does not interfere in individual karma. It is not that Bhagwan will specially bless somebody who has done puja and curse somebody who has not done puja. That's why the Gita, he says, Samoham sarva bhuteshu name dveshyosti na priya. I am equal to all beings. He is not partial. It is like invoking the law. Suppose you know that sunlight is everywhere and you put convex lens, then what happens? The energy of the sun gets harnessed. And you can do whatever you want. Water is flowing, so much energy. The moment you put a dam, then harness the energy. Same way, when I do the prayer, I am harnessing, there's so much energy in my mind, it's just leaking away. I am getting focused. I am tapping that energy. That will help me to do the right type of action right now and also give me the strength to face whatever karma is there which has to come with dignity. So God doesn't interfere in individual karma. That's why Gurudev always said God is only the contractor executing the blueprint given by the architect, which is, just imagine, Bhagwan is our contractor. We are the architect. We are making our blueprint. How? Every moment I am giving the blueprint of my life by the thoughts that I think. Every minute, this is what I want. Through the desires. So no point in blaming God. In fact, Gurudev always used to say that God never created you to fail in life. Success is your birthright. Just that we don't know how to use this instrument called the mind, how to empower it, how to work in harmony with the laws of the world. And that's why when we apply just the third law, it is important that we understand that from that Sanchit bundle, whatever is ready to give result, that is the cause of my birth today. So God did not write that. Who wrote that? My own self. So destiny or fate is not written by God. It is my own past karma. I must understand that very clearly, that God does not write destinies of people. Imagine if he started writing destinies of people, what will happen? He may only become mad. Because he may wonder, is this the destiny I wrote for this fellow? No, God doesn't write destinies of people. It is our karma. So that is what we call as prarabdha or destiny or fate. What has already begun? Which you cannot stop. What has already begun means I have done those karmas in the past, now they are ready to give me result. Now I can't stop them. So I have to face the consequences. For that, whatever body I require, it may be human body, animal body, plant body, any body I require, I will get that. Do you believe that once a human, always a human? There are some people who believe, once a human, always a human. According to law of karma, we don't believe that. Because whatever karma phala is there, to exhaust that, whichever body is required, one will get that. That's why the scripture says, in the Kathopanishad it is said, yatha karma yatha shrutam. As per your karma and as per your knowledge, you get the next body. Not fixed that once a human, always a human. And that's why it is very, very rare to get a human body. We must put purusharatha and attain the self-knowledge and free ourselves from the selfishness and ego. Because next time when we get the human body, no guarantee. So this is prarabdha, and that's why destiny is our own past actions. It is not predetermined by this. We must be very clear. Otherwise, we are very nice in putting the blame. Why is your life like this? God did it. And Gurudev always said that in India, we have one excuse which nobody else has. Why are you not successful? Because Swamiji, that Shani is not in the right position. Abhi 7.5 years chal raha hai. no matter what I do, it will not work. But now that time is coming to an end, और मुझे किसी ने बोला कि साढ़े सात ही जब खत्म होती है तो शनि दे के जाता है. So I'm waiting now. इतना नुकसान हो गया, अभी तो कुछ दे के जाएगा. So you believe in that some destiny, some planet up there, and how much we do. घर को पूरा तोड़ देंगे. ये बाथरूम इधर था उसको इधर शिफ्ट करो, बेडरूम उधर था उसको उधर शिफ्ट करो. No doubt vastu is a science by itself. It will work. But do you think it is more powerful than our mind? Mind is the most powerful, and that we don't empower. एक नाम में एक एक I add कर दो, एक double G add कर दो, एक double M add कर दो, पूरी तकदीर बदल जाएगी. वाह रे वाह. Those are things which may have some relevance. Nobody is denying that. But if the mind is empowered, anything is possible. Why do I have to depend on any numerology, astrology, vastu shastra? I don't need to depend. Our own shastra tells us that, that empower the mind. So that is my prarabdha, that is my destiny, that is what I have created. And once I know that, we have chosen our environment. This is the beauty of Vedanta. The law of karma, if I really believe in, I have chosen my environment and my parents and everything in my life. I cannot blame anybody. I am not a product of accident, suddenly born to some two people. No. Everything that happens is karma. And one cannot say that certain things are chance and certain things are karma. That is again not tenable. It is a result of action that I have done. So, according to the karmic laws, I am born to certain parents. So one can't blame. The moment one believes in karma, the ball comes back to our court for everything, good also and bad also. Full responsibility is in our hands. Second is also we should know that because the results are governed by cosmic laws, I must know about these cosmic laws. That what are these internal cosmic laws? Today we are living in an age where people very strongly believe that there is nothing called right and wrong. It's all relative, Swamiji. It's all grey area. There's nothing called right and wrong. So many shastras are written precisely for that reason. Because there are grey areas, because it is difficult to find out what is right and wrong, we must have the capacity to find out what is right and wrong. And yes, things do change by time, no denial of that. So the factors change to determine what is right and wrong. But that does not deny that there is something called right and wrong. If there was nothing called right and wrong, then if somebody cheats me and loots away my money, I can't say anything. Because he felt it is right, I have to keep my mouth shut. No, there is. There are different criteria to find out what is right and wrong. And precisely that is why one must study the scripture to know what is right and what is wrong. Not for the sake of the world, but for my sake. I must know what is right and wrong because I am going to face the karma phala. Swamiji, how long should I be forgiving to that opposite person? That person continuously is torturing me. I don't want to forgive that person. Okay, don't forgive. Then who is bound? I am only bound. I am only creating negative karma. And is it not that we are seeing the same situation in Mahabharata? What all atrocities that Pandavas were subjected to continuously by the Kauravas. But what did Yudhishthira do? The very fact his name Yudhishthira is beautiful. Yudhishthiraha. Even in the most tense situation, one who remains steadfast, equanimous, he is called Yudhishthira. He was ready to forgive them. Thank you, forgive and forget. Let it be because we have to move on with life. Not because he did not have the power to retaliate. They have already defeated Kauravas twice earlier. But because the understanding is very clear that my karma, I only have to face. So they were ready to negotiate also and say, okay, you give us half the kingdom or you give us just few villages or just give us five villages or just give me one house. It's okay, we don't want property. It is not a war for property at all. It's a war now on principles because they didn't agree to give anything. So the idea is that when I study these cosmic laws, I save myself because then I understand this is the right way to act. Whether people believe that or they don't believe, it doesn't matter. It has no relevance. Because who will face that karma? I alone have to face my karma. See, the moment we realize that fact that I am alone, that's a big wake-up call. Generally, we don't realize that. We think that, yes, sab mere saath mein hai. Is Ratnakar, why did he transform into Valmiki? Because he realized that, oh my God, my karma, I only have to face. Even though I am doing it for my family, the family said so clearly to him that your duty is to take care of us, whichever way you take care, that is not up to us. Your negative karma, we are not going to share. What a shock he got that day. That was his turning point. Saying, if I have to face my own karma, what am I doing? Buddha, why did he transform? Because he also realized that ultimately desire is the root cause of all evil. And old age, disease and death, if that is what is life going to be and everybody has to face that, then better seek that which is permanent. The moment he realized that I am alone and I have to face the consequences of my own karma and I cannot get away with it and there will be nobody else to share with me. That's why there is a PJ which says that success is very relative. Why? Because when there is success, there are relatives. When there is no success, all gone. Why? Because I have to face it all alone. So when I know this, then I better study the law. What is the Shastra saying? What is right and wrong? How to determine? And then let me do karma according to that. So that was the third law. Fourth law, the doer is the experiencer of the result. No one can escape the karma phala. And it cannot be that you are punished for my karma. So many of you are sitting here waiting for 20 minutes. You may say that we suffered for your karma, so you came late. But so many people came late, na, after me. They didn't suffer. Why? Because there was no karma that they had to suffer. So it's your karma, my karma, there's also called collective karma, mutual karma. So doer only will experience the result. Doer can never escape. So karma phala will come. And hence, in the present birth, what we are facing is the result of our past. In the future, we have to face the result of our own present karma. That is why let us live righteously, nobly. And this choice each one of us has, that no matter what I have been till yesterday, today I can decide to change and begin a new chapter. I don't have to bother. Whatever karma of the past is there, it will come. That time I will face it with dignity, but I can make a conscious choice and say, bas, enough is enough, it's over, now I change. That's how transformation happens. So when I understand this very clearly, that let me change, let me transform. Whatever is my past, in the Gita Bhagavan says that, apichet su durachara, meaning one who has a double PhD in all the crimes, su durachara. He has not left anything undone. Everything he has done. But bhajate mam ananyatha. That person has resolved to transform and he seeks the Supreme. Sadhu reva samantavya. You consider that person as good only. Why? Samyak vyavasito hi sah. That person has resolved very well that enough is enough now. Whatever has happened is done. I transform today. I may have been very lazy till yesterday, from today onwards I put my life into discipline. Change. I may have been selfish till yesterday, today onwards I change. That power to change we have. And so many people have utilized that power and transformed their lives. So this is law number 4. Law number 5, every action will produce two results. Visible result and invisible result. This visible result is what is experienced by us at the body, mind, intellect level. So suppose somebody gives me coffee, not ordinary coffee. So when I sip that coffee, Brahmananda also is nothing in front of me. It's dark. I am not drunk, so I don't know, I'm just saying. I have not missed anything, na? That though I know. So, इस दुनिया में कुछ मिस करने लायक है ही नहीं. पूरी पूरी दुनिया पे नहीं है तो स्टारबक्स कॉफी में क्या है. सो एनीवे चलो इट्स नॉट स्टारबक्स कॉफी व्हाटएवर ब्लैक फॉरेस्ट पेस्ट्री चलो समबडी दिस वी ट्राई टू गेट आउट ऑफ संसार पीपल ट्राई टू गेट इनटू ब्लैक फॉरेस्ट एनीवे सो ईट ब्लैक फॉरेस्ट एंड द मोमेंट आई ईट फिजिकल प्लेजर इज देयर. If somebody who is very dear to me has brought it, then I feel so thrilled that this person cares for me so much. Emotional joy is also there. And if there is an occasion to celebrate and I have been very successful and then this also comes, then it is like the icing on the cake. Wow. This is the visible result. What is the invisible result here? An impression or a vasana. That next time celebration is equal to black forest. So that impression is created. Suppose I don't like black forest, then the impression created will be black forest is equal to misery. So one impression goes. And that impression will create further desire next time. Either for something or run away from it. This subtle impression is the seed which we call as vasana. Which is what causes desire, thoughts, and then finally the action. That vasana is the subtlest of karma. So it is not only feeling and thought, it is the vasana. Every action that I do, if I strengthen this raga and dvesha, I like it, I want it more, then I am creating that vasana. If I strengthen the dvesha, saying, you know, I don't like it, this is not nice, then I am creating that vasana. If I eat and drop it then and there, there is no such equation which is created in the mind. That requires a lot of alertness. Then I am not creating further karma. So this applying this law number 5, while enjoying whatever prarabdha we are going through now, if I don't be alert, then I am creating new impression. That is what we call as the agami karma, which is the karma phala, karma which has not yet given result and is getting added into my total bundle. These impressions create this thoughts, action, thought, desire, action and results. And hence, these invisible results at the end of this body get added to my Sanchit Karma. So now just imagine, because of karma I am born to exhaust some karma. But while exhausting this karma, what I am doing? Adding more. Now think about it, those people who say, Hum toh khali haath aaye hain, khali haath jayenge. कुछ भी नहीं भर भर के लाए हैं और भर भर के ले जा रहे हैं फिजिकली खाली हाथ आए खाली हाथ जाएंगे लेकिन वासना माय गॉड हाउ मेनी वासना वी हैव ब्रॉट एंड हाउ मेनी वासना वी आर एडिंग मोर दैट्स द रीजन व्हाई वन हैज टू बी सो अलर्ट एंड अवेयर ऑफ व्हाट इज दिस कर्मा हाउ इज दिस इंप्रेशन गेटिंग फॉर्म्ड एंड हाउ एम आई एक्टिंग इन दिस वर्ल्ड जनरली वी आर नॉट इवन अवेयर ऑफ इंटेंशन व्हाइल एक्टिंग Why did I suddenly react to somebody? I don't even know at that time. Later on, if I sit and introspect, I may be aware, oh, this is exactly why I got angry. That introspection also many of us don't do. And what to talk about is vasana, impression is very, very subtle. So this is the fifth law because of which we are creating new karma. Impressions create desires, they create thoughts, they create action, they create results. And result being temporary, again it will create new impressions. Now this cycle goes on. This cycle is called as the karma bandhan or karma chakra. To exhaust this, we take birth again and again. That's why we say punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. Again and again we are born, again and again we die, go into the mother's womb. Why? Because we have the karma. The seed is there. Now it has to get exhausted. One cannot escape. And the only way to escape. Do we want to escape? I'll take 5 minutes more. Is it okay?
Yes.
Then this chapter gets over today. So law number 6 says what we have seen earlier. The motive of the action decides the merit of the action, the intention. Now if the intention is selfish, it will strengthen the ego, it will strengthen the impressions. And that's why it keeps us in bondage. Because the doership remains intact, absolutely intact. However selfless I may become, intention may be selfless, but ahankar remains. That's why our Guruji, Swami Tejomayanandji, he says so nicely that people are very concerned about blood pressure, BP, but they are not concerned about EP, ego pressure. That how high is the ego pressure? Big, big things also you see happening because of ego pressure. Whole American government shut down. Why? Ego. Republican. 15 din, 20 din, my God. Top level companies. In family. Ego. Everywhere you will find, even in a small little place you will find ego happening. That's why? Because selfishness. Even if I transform that into selflessness, the doership will still remain. That's why in Vedanta we always say that it is not enough to be good and do good. There are many people who come and say, Swamiji, is it okay? This is too much of technicality, Vedanta and all that. Why? I don't want to study. I believe in simple philosophy. Be good and do good, boss. Can I really do good keeping my ego intact? Somewhere selfishness will come or not? Even if I do karma yoga, why did Bhagwan have to give 18 chapters of the Gita? He would have shut with karma yoga, saying ki bas itna karte raho. Be good and do good, Arjun, there is no need of anything else. Why did he go up to dhyan yoga and obliteration of the ego and rising to know the divine? Because real goodness comes only when there is spiritual strength and there is surrender of that ego. Such a beautiful point of the Gita it is. Arjun could have been given a motivational talk. Arjun, you are a Kshatriya, come on, fight for Dharma, everybody is waiting for you. Don't quit now, you can win the war, yes, you can do it. But Bhagavan didn't give him a pep talk. He gave him the deepest knowledge, which is self-knowledge. That's why I always say that it is not enough to be good. Was Arjun a good person or not? Did he do any wrong? Did he suffer so much because of his bad karma? Why did he collapse in that field? He was a good person only, no? Why that good person still collapsed? Because that goodness is not enough. So we should not only be good, we should be spiritually good. What was the difference before the Gita and after the Gita? Arjuna was given spiritual knowledge. That spiritual knowledge combined with that goodness, he got that tremendous amount of strength. So it's not enough to be good, it has to be spiritual good. That's why I need anchoring in spiritual knowledge. That's why Gurudev gave us so much of knowledge. He made us independent. There is no cult in Chinmaya mission. There is no, one God you have to keep following or one Guru you have to keep following. He gave us the Shastra saying, this is the Gita, this is the Upanishad, this is what the Shastra says. Now you are independent. You live your life according to these principles and make your life. Complete freedom. To choose which path you want, how you want to live, do what you want. Because it's your life. He made us independent. In fact, he would not want people to be dependent on him. Very rare you find such a master. So knowledge is so important that it transforms that goodness into spiritual goodness. Even that spiritual goodness is not enough. Are there not enough spiritually good people? Still, why all this is happening? Because they are not aggressively good and they are not unitedly good. So I have to be good, not enough. I have to be spiritually good, aggressively good and unitedly good. All the good people need to come together. The reason why good people are not coming together is because of the spiritual goodness is not there. So each one's ego comes. Even in social service organizations and spiritual organizations, it happens everywhere. So that's why the selfish motive one must drop. This whole organization which has been done of these yajnas. So many people have worked selflessly for so many days. Then you all are sitting here and we are benefiting from this satsang. In spite of all the work that they have in their home, in their profession, they take out time, they organize, they do publicity, raise funds. All that is done. What is the motive? Let people get knowledge. And there's a group of committed people who have come together. There will be differences in that group also. Everywhere, when people come together, there will be differences. But that's where we say, Yajna spirit, come together in a selfless cause, sinking your differences for a noble goal and serve. That way, if good people come together, aside their selfishness and ego and work completely involved in the noble cause. Then that work is called as a prayer, and that work benefits and that work reduces the ego. So selfish karma, selfish motive will reduce, selfish motive will increase the ego. Selfless motive will reduce, and that's why we need a field to serve. This is the key. I can liberate myself if I learn to be selfless. I can be selfless wherever I am. I don't have to do special karma for it. When we come to karma yoga on the third day, I will explain more about that. Karma yoga is not some special action only. It's a very beautiful aspect of what is karma. How to move from karma to karma yoga. So to summarize, these are the three types of karma. Sanchita is our total karma. Prarabdha is our destiny which we have created. And Agami is, while going through destiny, I am creating my own future karma. So free will or choice, because we have this capacity to choose our own future, we have this blessing, and those who realize this blessing, they can get out of karma. That's why Gurudev always said that what we meet in life is fate, but how we meet it is our free will. And I always say this PJ, one of my favorite PJ. If your father is poor, it is your fate. If your father-in-law is poor, it is your foolishness. In fact, Gurudev always said that there is nothing called fate. Why? Because yesterday's free will is today's fate. Today's free will is tomorrow's fate. So fate being a creature of free will, how can fate be more powerful than free will? How can I resign my life to fate? Kya ho sakta hai, kuch nahi hoga, jo hona hai, wohi hoga. And many people become defeatist like that, ki abhi mere se kya hone wala hai, wo Bhagwan jo karega, wo karega. Suddenly now Bhagwan karega. There is no separate fate. Yesterday's free will is today's fate. So go through it in dignity, that whatever has happened yesterday, okay, let me go through it. But today I can change and create a new destiny altogether. So that's why the topic of fate versus free will actually is a misnomer. There is nothing called fate versus free will, because yesterday's free will only is today's fate. So it is fate and free will. In fact, it should be free will and fate, because yesterday's free will is today's fate. Hence we say that destiny is not in the lines of your hand, but in the grasp of your palms. How I grasp the present moment, that determines my future. So with that, we stop for today. If there are obstacles which we find in our fate, in our present moment, that only means that yesterday I did some karma which is conflicting with today. So I must ensure that I keep putting my effort more and more and more today to nullify the effect of the past. So it's only an indicator of free will, that I am not putting in enough free will. I should. If I am made for it, I am convinced that this is my swadharma, then just put the free will. Keep putting more and more purushartha. Whatever is the past of yesterday will get obliterated. Example given is a nail hammered in the wall. So if 10 years ago a nail has been hammered, it has gone very deep. Now today I am putting some effort to pull it out. Will it just come out? No. Until I match the effort that was put that time, the resistance of the wall and all that. So will I say that, you know, the wall is putting obstacles? What will I do? Pull with more force. That's all. Same thing has to be done. If I am convinced that this is what I am made for, this is the goal, and I am not able to achieve it, keep putting effort. So coming back to those questions, is man fated by fate? No. He is only influenced by fate. That is his own karma. Yesterday's karma has an influence on me today. Nobody can deny that. But it cannot completely limit me. Does man have any free will? Yes. In the present he has complete free will. How free is his will? Time and cosmic laws will govern the result. In action he has complete free will. But in results he does not have the free will. Should man free his will? Yes. Become free from the ego and go beyond fate and free will. So that is where we stop for today. Tomorrow our topic will be six types of karma. Today what you have seen is Sanchita, Agami and Prarabdha. But in our daily life there are six types of karma, which is a different classification, not these three. This is one classification to understand the theory of karma properly. Now in the daily life, what are the karmas that we should do, which we should not do? And if we land up doing something wrong, how do you correct all that? So that will be our topic for tomorrow. And tomorrow we will start at 7 sharp. Thank you very much. If at all you have any questions, then I would suggest you can write them down with your name and leave it here tomorrow. At the end of the session or during the session, whatever way it permits, we will answer those questions. Thank you. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Guru Namaha. Hari Om. Those of you who are new, if you would like to be